For as long as I can remember, I have been in love with stories. Legends, folklore, and tales of magic and mystery always brought me a sense of wonder and soon became my favorites. In my mind, those types of stories always made the world more magical, and life just seemed more fun that way. Naturally, my love of art and lore started to merge. Hey guys, welcome to or back to my channel. I cannot tell you how excited I am about this series, this collaboration, and even the artist commentary videos that are going to go along with art and lore. I have been so excited about this and been thinking about it and trying to produce it since the Inktober of 2018. I feel like that has been the most me thing that I have done on this channel so far since starting it, and I could not be more excited to launch this series, and I am so excited that the day is finally here. If you are watching this from the cellar, thank you so much for signing up for my email list. I truly, truly appreciate you guys, and I hope you enjoy the early access to the artist commentary for art and lore. If you are watching this on my YouTube channel and you're like, what is the cellar? Oh my god, I have no idea what you're talking about. Basically, if you go to my website and you sign up for my email list, you will get the password to my secret page on my website called The Cellar. On that page, there are free wallpapers, a coupon code for my shop, and early access to videos like this one. If you are interested in that, I will leave a link in the video description below so you can check that out. So, on to the artist commentary type of video that we're gonna do here. And what I wanna do with the artist commentary is make it sort of like a podcast and just kind of chat casually about the art piece, the struggles that I faced, because this one was a tough one. Basically, just have a casual chat about what art and lore is and what I want to do with it, what me and Raven just have planned. Like, everything is just so exciting right now, and I can't contain my excitement. And during one of these commentaries, we'll bring Raven into the mix to talk about the experiences with art and lore and how she feels about it, and just all the things that are related to art and lore is what we're going to talk about here. And it's probably going to be very babbly in a sense, and I sort of kind of prefer those videos to the scripted ones, but I love them both, and I just wanted to have kind of like a behind the scenes type of video and what went into the artwork and what went into the story making and all the things that go along with that. So one of the first things I want to talk about is the collab with Raven. What I wanted to do, I could not do alone. As much of a storyteller I want to be, I want to write, I want to produce, I want to narrate well, unfortunately, my skill set in that department was just not quite up to par. And I reached out to Raven and said, hey, would you like to do this with me? I think it could be something that your audience will like, and along with mine as well. And, you know, you have such a lovely voice. I would love to combine the two, my art, your voice, and just kind of produce this this thing that I can't do on my own. And while I hone my narration and storytelling skills, I'm just so grateful and honored that Raven said yes to this collaboration, and I'm so excited to continue on with the series. So as of right now, we have a collaboration playlist set up to where we can each add our art and lore videos to that playlist. So I will have that linked in the video description as well. So we'll each be putting out an art and lore at the same time whenever we do that. And we will continue to add to the playlist and see how it goes. So basically, we're going to be combining art and folklore. And I'm assuming we're going to run out of folklore at some point. So we might have to venture off into fairy tales and mythology and anything that's an old story, basically, I don't see us not touching. And for the first one here that I chose Will-o'-the-Wisp. And I think I'm just kind of working my way back through that Inktober 2018 project and just kind of redoing all the pieces from that. But I might not do it in that order. I don't know. But I really wanted to give Will-o'-the-Wisp another go, especially with Inktober, because you didn't have that much time to really put time and effort into a piece like that the way that I wanted to produce it like this. So I decided to just kind of to go back to where the inspiration for art and lore came from and just start with one of those and redo it and give it new life. And I am happy to report that I do think that this piece came out a hell of a lot better than the last one that I only had a few hours to work on. I do really wish that I had the thumbnail image that I did in the sketchbook looked better, where it was wider and thinner than this rectangular type of piece. I don't know. I feel like if I would have did it like I did it in the sketchbook and made it a little bit longer, almost like a movie screen where you have the black bars on the top and the bottom, I feel like it looked more like a scene that way. So if I do another landscape, I will definitely probably make it more cinematic looking on paper, if that makes any sense. But yeah, all in all, very happy with how this came out. It's been weeks in the making. It took me quite a while to get this done, and I think a lot of it was mental. Like, I was scared to launch the series, scared that my artwork wouldn't live up to Raven's narrating, just scared in general that people wouldn't like art and lore as much as I loved it, and I just... So I procrastinated a lot, and this piece stayed in the ugly stage for quite a while. Sorry about the beeping. There's some kind of loud truck outside my window, because why not? Thankfully, like I said, this type of commentary is just not going to be as well produced as the original art and lore video. So I hope you guys are okay with that. But yeah, this piece was very, very challenging for me. I was very, very afraid to finish and very afraid that it wouldn't come out the way I envisioned, and very, very afraid that the series wouldn't do well. I still, right now at the time of the recording, I have no idea how it went. I have no idea how the premieres went. I'm just hoping that at least my normal group of people that like the storytelling aspect in the videos really enjoy this. Obviously, I will be making other things for my other viewers, but I do really want to focus on storytelling and get better at that, and obviously get better at art. Originally, I was going to make this video like a tutorial, but I don't see myself as a tutorial person. I feel like I'm unworthy. I don't know if it's an imposter syndrome. There's just so many other great artists out there that I feel like people can learn from, and I don't understand why they would come to me, but I mean, if that's the case and you guys do want tutorials, I mean, I will do my best. I think I prefer to do that type of thing live. Just so you can see the real-time version of it and see how I work through my mistakes. And I feel like that's the biggest part that I don't like about tutorials on the internet is that I feel like everybody has their own way of doing things, and there's always more than one way to do things. And there's always these people that come out of the woodwork like, you're doing it wrong, this and that, and this and that. And it's just, I feel like everybody has their own way of teaching and their own way of doing things. So if I do a tutorial, there probably is going to be like a disclaimer in front of it. But I think I prefer to do that kind of thing live so people can ask questions as I'm doing it or while things are drying. And, I feel like, every piece that every artist does, I don't feel like it goes according to plan. I feel like every artist on every piece runs into something that they didn't plan for, and how they overcome that obstacle is how the piece came out. You know what I'm saying? Like, I don't feel like they're intentionally experimenting on a piece. But I always run into problems that I didn't think I was going to run into. And I feel like a lot of other artists run into those problems too. And I feel like it's kind of, they don't admit that in the tutorial stage of art. And I feel like, you know what I mean? Like, I know people run into problems every time they do something because there's no project that you're doing, whether you don't run into a problem, whether it's crochet, a home decor project or a house renovation, you always run into things that you didn't expect to run into. And I feel like nobody admits that when they do tutorials. So maybe that'll be my original thing, I guess. Like, this is a problem I ran into. I have no idea how to fix it, but somehow I managed to make it work kind of situation. And I do feel like that's one of the thing that artists that do tutorials don't admit is that they are always a student. They are always considered a student because there's always more to learn. And I always tend to shy away from the people that claim to know everything about that one thing because, in all honesty, you really don't. There's always something to learn. And that's something that I think that people who do art understand, but the comparison monster comes into effect in a piece that they admire that somebody else did. I don't think that artist intended it to come out that way. I think that's just the way that it turned out. I mean, some people do get lucky, and I get lucky occasionally when I plan so much that it, you know what I mean? Like, if you plan enough, the piece comes out as you intended. But like, even this one, I planned a lot. I did thumbnails, I did color tests, and I still ran into things that I didn't think I was going to run into. And I feel like that's the artist's journey. That is the thing that you have to work through, and I feel like everybody runs into that. I feel like every artist makes decisions on the go. I mean, like, if you watch Aaron Blaze, his live streams, you know, like he makes decisions on the fly. Like, I think that's just my problem with tutorials. I feel like people don't admit that, you know, mistakes happen, and you know, like, you want to seem so professional that it's hard to be authentic in a way, I guess. I mean, I'm assuming, I mean, that's just where I am. I'm assuming that a lot of professional artists have their pieces come out exactly the way they wanted them to, and I feel like that's years under their belt of getting it wrong and working through problems. So if you are at the beginning stages of your art, just know that a lot of us run into problems with every piece. So don't think that you're failing because you're running into things that you didn't expect to run into. You know, like, there's always going to be somebody better than you at something, and you're always going to be better than somebody else at something. But I feel like what a lot of artists don't admit in the tutorial sense of things is that, in the words of Bob Ross, I mean, the happy accidents, the things you learn from the happy accidents that you didn't plan for, become this arsenal of knowledge in your next piece. So it's just it's just like this library that you keep up in your head, and you refer back to that. And how did I get over that one problem that I did back then? And how did I make this look like this? And it's just one of those things that can never, it feels like it never can fully be mastered the way you want to express it. I feel like you're always behind, like in your mind, you're a couple years ahead of where you want to be physically, and you have to really work to get to that point. And then by the time you get to that point, you're more years ahead in your work, in your mind, than you are physically able to accomplish it. Like right now with the art and lore videos, like in my head, I have it envisioned, filmed so much better in my head. So I have the option to stop and nitpick and wait until it's perfect to launch it, or launch it now and improve it as it continues. So that's what I'll be doing from now on. Like, I know things are not going to be the way I originally envision, but as long as I keep going, eventually I might be able to get to that point. So anyway, moving on from that tutorial ramble, we'll touch base on that on a different day. So what I want to talk about is what excites me most about the project. And I feel like, for one, I haven't seen it that somebody has done this already. I haven't seen this. So hopefully me and Raven are filling a need that we didn't know people needed, I guess. I know there's, you know, channels that talk about mythology and lore and creatures and things that actually have artwork displayed, but I've never seen someone actually make an art piece dedicated to a piece of lore and have it play in the background while the lore is being read. And I feel like not only is that something that I would truly enjoy, because I'm a big fan of story. I'm just such a big fan of story. I love watching Ancient Aliens. I love watching, you know, like the ghost stories. Not so much of the ghost hunting itself, but I like the story behind the haunting. And I like how the people experience it while they're there. And I feel like if you go back to where, like, these stories came from, it's just, you know, it's like you wonder how the lore came about. Did they actually see something that night that science couldn't dispute, or was it all made up for other purposes? Was it made up a story for escaping the real life? I mean, like, I can't imagine how real life was back then, you know, like, I know most of the grim fairy tales were basically warnings to children to, like, not venture out into the woods and, you know, not talk to strangers and things like that. But you have to wonder if at some point, was any of it real? Like, did they really see something? Was there really a will-o'-the-wisp out there? Or was it just some kind of swamp gas or whatever they claim it to be? Scientific wise, you know, did they see a leprechaun is magic real? Were there witches? Were the Greek gods a real thing? Like, where did all these stories come from? Was it just somebody's imagination trying to escape their real life? Or was it something that they actually saw? And I like to believe that it's something that they thought they actually saw, because a life with magic in it is just so much better than not. Like, I just feel like it's so much more fun that way. And currently, you know, in the state of the world and with the move that we just did, and it has been a rough winter here, a rough winter. And I tell you what, fantasy is my preferred genre of books. And it is such a nice escape to go to a different place when the world around you is just crumbling. I feel like it's like story can just save you from reality in some sense. And it's currently my situation at this time. Like, books are really helping me get through the depression of the winter. And it's just so exciting to believe that all these worlds could be real. All of them. Like, even though they came out of somebody's head and were jotted down on paper, just imagination itself is so amazing. Like, I just, how people dream up these places and things and spirits and lights and magic and all of the things that surround that, I just feel like it's such a wonderful thing to experience and to read about, you know, like what these authors and storytellers tell you. Like, it's just so, such a relief to be able to have an escape, to imagine a different place, to imagine a different world, to imagine different creatures and things that you don't typically see every day. You know, you go and you work your 9-to-5, you come home, and to fall into a book that just takes you to another place just seems so magical and so life-saving in a sense for so many people, that it's just something that I really wanted to be a part of. You know, just to imagine that you're having a horrible day and you take a walk in the woods and you run to something that you didn't expect to run into, and it just takes you to a whole different place. Imagination is a wonderful thing. Such a cool thing, imagination. Even in people's artwork too, you know, like, they can imagine these scenes and environments in their head and put it to paper, and so someone else can experience what they experience inside their head. I just think it's so cool. And it's just definitely something that, you know, lights a spark in you when you don't feel like you have any spark left. Like, even this piece right now, could you imagine seeing this in real life? How cool would that be? I mean, it might be a little terrifying because there's little monster eyes and little creepy crawlies in here, but to see magic firsthand, like, if you could pop into a painting and just see it in real life and just be like, wow, you know, like, it's just, it's one of those things where you, there's no words to describe it. That is one of the things that I think is most powerful about story and art and artists and authors and storytellers, is that even if you can't travel and see the world and see all these magical places in real life, I mean, like, nature itself is just magical as it is. You know, the moon phases and the tides and the oceans and the forests and all of that, and you add an author or an artist to that, and suddenly you have this magical place that you obviously can't see in real life, but let's say you couldn't travel, you know what I mean, and then you go to an art museum and just see things that you've never seen before. Like, when I went to the DIA, I mean, like, just, you know, the Detroit Institute of Arts, for those of you who don't know or live in Michigan, there was You know, so many different cultures have their own stories too, which I feel like makes it that much more awe-inspiring. Like the one level they had all these this Greek pottery and just the stories that were encrypted on these vases and the Pegasus and, you know, Zeus and just like where did all this stuff come from? You know what I mean? Like, oh my God. And I mean, I know a lot of it was probably just like misleading, unscientific information. And I mean, a lot of it could have been mental illness and, you know, people hallucinating and just seeing things that just weren't there. But the stories that came out of it, I think, are really awe-inspiring. And just, you know, I mean, come on, Hercules, like, the monsters that go along with Hercules and the trials that he had to do, like, it's just one of those things that is just like so wow. Like, you know, like you want to experience it, but you don't want to experience it because it's truly terrifying kind of situation. And it's so hard to put into words what story and art can do to the soul. Wow, I feel like I'm like beyond gushing and you guys are getting way too much information out of me, but like I just feel like that's what it is. I feel like that's the art of soul. I feel like there's so much to convey that we can't really put into words. So artists and storytellers, we make you see through imagination a place that you can't get to in any other way, if that makes sense. Oh man, yeah, I feel like you guys are getting to know way too much about me, and you might think I'm just like this gullible little kid or something, but there's just something so powerful about story and art, and I just feel like when you combine them, you get something truly magical. It gives you a visual to go along with the words, and then you're transported into this place, and it's just like, man, imagination is cool, you know? But it's like also, was it imagination or was it real? Like, nobody knows. And that's what's so great about it, you know? Like, the dinosaurs were real, but like, everybody's like, dragons are fake. And I'm like, but they're really not, you know what I mean? Like, they could be the same thing. So it's, you know, like, it's just shit that makes you go, huh? Stuff that makes you go, huh? That's definitely, it's just stuff that fuels me. You know what I mean? Like, where do you go when you die? Like, is there a heaven and hell? What, you know, is there an in-between? Is there a limbo? Is there a purgatory? Is there, like, nobody can really confirm or deny. There's so many things that are so unexplored right now that it's just funner to believe. You know, like, chupacabra, real thing or nah? Nobody knows. They can say that it's not, but like we haven't explored every inch of this planet. Like nobody officially knows if it's real or not. Do you know how many species are discovered every day? Nobody has any idea what's real or fake at this time, and it's just like, I don't know. It's very interesting. It's very interesting. I always feel like believing is better than not believing. But, you know, there's something truly terrifying in believing also, if you think about it, because not everything's warm and fuzzy, but could be cool. Could be cool. I don't know. Anyway, moving on. Oh man, I have a feeling I'm gonna regret publishing this video. There's gonna be so many people coming at me like, you are so dumb. There's no such thing as monsters, but like, there probably could be. I mean, there's human monsters, and in some cases, they're a lot worse than fake ones. So, anyway, what do we plan to do with art and lore is the next question. And I have to say that I can't speak for Raven right now, and one of these days we're gonna get her on the artist commentary part of the playlist. But for me, what I would like to do with it would be a monthly release of a new piece and a new narrated you know, scripted version along with the artist commentary part of it. And eventually, you know, if it continues and it does well, an art book would be just really cool to have the story and the artwork put together along with the sketches and some extra sketches. I mean, like, who knows? It could just be a really nice finished product. And not so much as a product, but like just to have everything in one place at the end would be cool. I think we both agreed to at least do a year's worth of these videos. So should at least be 12 apiece for now. Things might change. I don't know how it's going to go, but we'll see. If it does well, I don't see why we wouldn't continue on. And I feel like it's really fun. Obviously you've gotten to know me a little bit too much, in my opinion, but, I don't know. Hopefully you find it exciting, at least, like, and it distracts you from your daily life and gives you a sense of peace or fun or wonder or, you know, anything to go along with your good day. But, I think a book, an art book with the stories included, that we collab on, I think that would be really fun. A podcast might be in the future. I don't know. I don't know where this could go, but I know that it's the only thing that's really excited me in a long time. And I've been wanting to do it for 2019, for at least 3 years. I've been wanting to produce it in this way, and I'm so thrilled that Raven Reed said yes and decided to narrate, because I just feel like it brings the project together so nicely as a whole, and it's just a really nice end product video-wise for us. I mean, granted, I know as we go on, I'm sure we're going to want to improve and improve video and sound and music, and obviously, I'm going to keep improving the artwork, which would be great. But, I think we're both just really, really excited about what's going to go on in the future. And I think it's going to be a really exciting journey. And I hope you all are as excited about it as we are. So what I want to talk about next is the stories that I definitely want to do in the future as far as this goes. And I would love your opinions and suggestions down below. That would definitely help move us along to know if you're excited to see a specific folklore turned into illustration / story combination. I do know that for sure I do want to hit Greek mythology at some point, and I really want to redo the Fates, especially because I did it in that Inktober from 2018, and I'm just like not thrilled with it at all, and I would really like to give that another go. I don't know how I feel about some of the rest of them. I know I do want to touch some cryptids. I'd like to do the Loch Ness Monster, the Kraken. And I would like to do, Mothman again. I was not really happy with my Mothman piece. And I feel like that story is really fascinating. I don't know what it is. Maybe it's more of, like, the movie, the Mothman prophecies. I feel like that's maybe the intriguing part of it. But, there's just so many stories that I want to hit and do. But the Fates is really, ringing out to me right now. And I know I wouldn't mind hitting kind of like the urban legend thing again. I know Bloody Mary I would love to redo. What else did I have in there? I need to grab my books. But as fun as it was, like the Inktober part of it and having to finish it in a day was just, I think it posed a stepping stone for what we're doing now. But, in the beginning, I know I was really excited then, and I was excited to get it done, but it was so ill-consuming that that's all I was doing, and I felt like I let some of my other things slide during that Inktober. But I was also a little disappointed with the artwork at that time, because it was just one of those things that I wanted to do really well, and I just felt like I didn't have the time for. I think that's partly why I've been studying so much. Like, I feel like environment studies, animal studies, anatomy studies, that's why I did anatomy for, I did bones last Inktober, and surprise of all surprises, I actually finished that sucker, which was so great. I was so bummed that we had to move that quickly after that, because I felt like I was on a roll as far as art went, and like a consistent upload on YouTube, and then we had to move relatively quickly. We ended up finding mold in our house, and it's become a whole to-do, so we had to get out of there for health reasons, and I'll share that in a different video, I guess. But yeah, so setting up the new space was irritating, and I'm still not 100% positive or happy with how it's set up. Like, I feel like a little bit smothered, but I do have all of my things in here, like my printer and my Cricut and all that. So there is enough counter space for those things, but I do still feel really crammed, and I don't feel like completely happy in the space. Like, I don't really like to be in this room, which is still unfortunate. Like, I haven't found my happy painting place yet, and it just makes me sad. But anyway, back to the stories and folklore that I would like to touch on. I know for sure I would love to get into the Greek mythology part of it, partly because I want to get into acrylics and oils, and I feel like that kind of stuff should be on canvas. And I also feel like it would be really cool to have like a Bigfoot on canvas, Nessie on canvas, like just all of those things that you typically see like graphically or digitally depicted, you know, like the alien shirts and all that. Like, it's just, it's very digital looking to me, and I'm really curious to see how it would come out in an acrylic painting by my hand, or even watercolor. Like, I'm not sure what I would, like, medium I would like to do, but I do know that I am just fascinated by folklore and mythology and fairy tales, old dark fairy tales, along with the urban legends. Like, I just am so fascinated by these stories and where they came from and the inspiration, that I want to put my own Kelly Paints twist on it and just kind of make it different, but also familiar, if that makes any type of sense. And I know I would like to do, I feel like I'm rambling. I don't know what I said. But yeah, that's why I was doing the studies, was to improve on the imaginative realism part of it, because there's not officially like a Mothman for me to go look at, or a Loch Ness Monster or Bigfoot or whatever. So you have to take those studies and those environments and combine them together to make this kind of imaginative, realistic scene that it's challenging but also really exciting. So I've been studying a lot, and that's why I did bones for the Inktober last year, and I feel like I'm really getting a handle on anatomy and animal anatomy and bones and things. Like, I'm just getting really excited about art again, and it feels very, very good. Feels beyond good, actually, because I was really on a roll, and I was really bummed that I had to put it aside to move and obviously set up the new studio space and all those things. And like, I don't feel like this is my permanent space either. I feel like I already feel smothered in here, and I would like a place that can fit my sewing stuff, my crochet stuff, all of my books, and just, you know, like, have my own area in the world that just has all of my favorite things in it, and in one spot, and just for me to go and be creative. That's away from the noise of the house and the noise of the kids and the dogs and As much as I love them, which I do, but when I'm trying to be creative, I feel like I just need this. I need to be in such solitude that it's really hard for me to find it, like a good place to work. But fear not, I shall persevere, and I'm grateful that I have a room at all, to be honest. I know a lot of people are working on their kitchen tables, and I totally respect that, and I'm not trying to sound ungrateful or whatever, but I have a dream studio space, and I would absolutely love to make that a reality, and it's not like putting a damper on me being ungrateful, or I know that there's people that would kill for the space that I have, so I am grateful for my space. I just, I have a dream, man, and I'm pretty excited to get there. All right, so let's move on and talk about some, I feel like I need to update you guys. I don't know why I said that two times, but I'm not going to edit it out because, like I said, this is going to be a very rambly and chatty video, so... If you don't like this one, I guess just continue watching the art and lore that's, you know, produced in a way that can be easily consumed. But if you, you know, wanted an update on my life and what's going to happen next, then this video is for you, obviously. But so I keep moving the studio around because I'm not quite happy with how it's laid out right now. So there will be a studio tour coming very, very soon, as soon as I get all my stuff situated in the way that, like, I did this piece and I kind of got a feel for how I want to work in this space, and it's very different from my other space. So trying to figure out where I want to store things and have them within reach while I'm working, obviously, is a big key factor of that. So I'm still setting it up and moving things around to my liking. And once I get it officially set up the way I like it, I will have a studio tour. So that is coming up. And I'm working on batch shooting some things. So when life goes awry the way that it's been going lately, I have some stuff to upload so I'm consistent and something that you can rely on as a creator, because that's always something that bothered me in the past, that I felt like a very unreliable creator. So I would like to be something that you can depend on, especially in these times. Like, we, you know, like, I had been hesitant to kind of launch art and lore recently because of everything that's happening with Ukraine right now, and I just kind of came to the realization that if I need a place to escape, that maybe somebody else needs a place to escape. So we decided to just go ahead and launch it so we could, you know, hopefully be that piece that people need when they want to escape the news and reality, I guess, in a sense. So speaking of that, the reliable thing, magical shit will continue on. I am working on my next piece for that. And I'm hoping to have that project finished by September so I can get the zines printed and have them in my shop by October. So that project will continue and the giveaway will still be happening. And I have, I'm getting all that stuff together. So I'm actually currently flattening out and scanning in some of the pieces and trying to put the zine together as I'm working. I'd like to make some things to go along with that too. So there'll be sticker sets, and I'm working on some clay pins that should be able to go with the magical ship project. So that's something to look forward to, and that is coming because I am still very, very happy with that project and I can't wait to see it in print. So that is still happening for the people that were like, where did you go? It's definitely still happening, and I'm still very, very proud of it, and I can't wait to see it finished and complete and, you know, have a reliable and an official giveaway like I had planned. And so all of that will continue. The next thing is that I plan to focus more on my store this year, so there will be more store drops and more things than just bookmarks. I'm really getting a handle for how my printer's working and how my Cricut works and just making these things. And I bought a pack of like 12 little canvases that I could practice the acrylic painting on, and I'd like to release those as originals in the future. Working on some merch that I've been wanting to design for about a year. So I'm really just getting in the flow of things again. I'm really putting a lot of effort into Kelly Paints this year. Because like I said, man, I have a dream, and I just really want to get better at my craft too. Like I don't want to just make content to make content. My point was to never go viral. It was to always just build a community of people that have the same like-mindedness as me and enjoy the same things that I like. And just have that community with them and be able to connect with that. And hopefully people connect with the art that I want to make and things that I want to produce. So I'm working on all of those things and really focusing on a content plan and a business plan, because this is something that I would really like to do for a long time. And even though I've been doing it for about 3 years, almost four now, I've been very inconsistent, and I don't like that. I don't like that at all, especially because I'm one of those people that I don't like unreliable people. But unfortunately, my life, most of you probably do or don't know, but I am a special needs mom, and I don't like to advertise that because there are just really hateful people in the world. So if I disappear, it's not because I'm being lazy. It's because my special needs life needs attention. So that's why I'm focusing on batch producing content while things are good, so I have things to post to you for when times are bad. But yeah, I typically don't like to advertise that, partly because it's really nobody's business what goes on in my personal life unless I feel like sharing it. So I probably won't talk about it again, because I'm hoping to have batch produce enough that I won't need to talk about it again. And I don't like to mention it in general, because like I said, there are just very hateful people on this planet, and I really don't want to encourage a debate in my comment section and blah blah blah. You know how that goes. Any kind of topic that's off topic from the art that goes along with my channel, I don't like to mention. As much as I know that connecting with the person is part of the journey and the process and why you like creators that you like, I like to keep it on topic and on point. Like, I don't like to veer off too much. I mean, obviously I mentioned the pandemic before, but I'd like to keep things on point and consistent enough to where it's something that you can rely on, that you're not going to hear controversial topics on or blah blah blah. So anyway, moving on. After the store attention, I do have, you know, like that dream studio I said that I wanted. It's something that would probably have to be built in the backyard. And unfortunately, the prices are too high right now, especially cement. So that's on hold temporarily. But being in the new studio that I am now, I plan on being in here for at least a year at a minimum, but it'll most likely be two. And we'll go from there. I'm not really in a hurry to get, I mean, like, I am in a hurry, but I'm not in a hurry to get it done, because financially it's just not a must at the moment. Would it be nice? Yes, absolutely. It definitely would be nice. But my main focus is to be consistent on my platforms and be a reliable creator. Obviously, I understand that, you know, everybody needs a break from social media. And though the winter was depressing, it was nice to take a break, especially after Inktober. I don't know why, but like, Inktober is, it's very exhausting and exhilarating at the same time, especially if you're able to finish it. But it is, it's definitely tiring, like creating that much stuff every day when I'm trying to get a consistent schedule to where I'm working like Monday through Friday and I take the weekends off. Like, obviously during Inktober there really is no weekends because you have to complete a piece every day. So that was a little tiring, and I do feel like self-care is important. So it's definitely a work-life balance that I'm working out, and hopefully I get it figured out to the point where things run very smoothly here. And I'm really looking forward to that. I don't know why, but it seemed like I kind of like went down in energy there. I definitely didn't intentionally do that. So yeah, I mean, like, I'm really excited about what's going to happen this year and how far we can get, how much the art's going to improve. And then one of the other main things that I have on my to-do list this year was when I got my new laptop, I had them put Final Cut Pro on it and install it previously. And so I'm taking Skillshare classes on how to use that. It's definitely way more complicated than iMovie, which I use right now. But I'm really, really excited about it and really looking forward to better quality of videos and color grading and storytelling within the video process. So that's something to look forward to too, is that I actually did upgrade my software, though it's not in this video because I'm still learning how to use it. It's way more complicated than I thought it was going to be, and I thought it was going to be very similar to iMovie, and it's got so many features and things that can you can add to it, like adding LUTs and color grading and God, there's so many things that I'm just trying to learn and learn slowly, so I get the hang of it very quickly, I guess. But yeah, no, so I'm really excited about this year and really excited about art and lore. I can't tell you how excited I am about art and lore, and with Raven Reads, I'm really hoping that it can be something that you guys truly enjoy. And as far as like life updates go, I mean, the move went pretty smoothly. We're mostly settled in now. I don't know why moving takes so long. It's not even like the moving, it's the unpacking and trying to figure out how to set up your new life. Like the kitchen was completely different, so I had to learn how to cook the other way, like the stove's on a different side of the counter. You know what I mean? Like all of that. And then, the oven works differently, and the house is set up completely differently, so we had to like really readjust, and our poor dogs were so confused for so long as to like where they were and which door to come in and things like that. So yeah, one we're pretty well adjusted now. We're looking forward to spring and being out in the yard and think everything that goes along with moving. I don't know why moving is so exhausting, but it is. It's very exhausting. And over the winter we had lost a few family members, mostly to old age, but when you add COVID into the mix and everything's just way more scary and sad, and you feel very secluded lately. But so we got through that, and then there was a couple hospitalizations that really kind of shook me. But I'm happy to report that we're doing well considering everything, and I'm really looking forward to getting back into a rhythm of creating and painting and hanging out with you guys on the internet and just getting back to life. I've been actually reading a lot of books. I think I've read 9 books. I'm actually almost finished with my 10th book this year so far. I have a goal to read 52 books this year, which is, obviously 1 book a week. I'm currently in the thralls of the Court of Thorn and Roses series, and it's just like blowing my mind. I always thought, like BookTube kind of like has mixed reviews on Sarah J. Maas, and I am happy to report that I was like, I'll try it. I'll see if, she's worth the hype or whatever. And I'm just kind of like, my heart hurts when I read the books, but like it's so moving, and it's exactly what I needed right now to get through my depression and from the winter. Not, anything seriously wrong, but seasonal depression here in the Midwest is definitely a thing. And gratefully, yesterday it was almost 60 degrees here, but unfortunately it's back to rain and cold today. But yeah, no, things have been good. I'm excited with the new space. I'm still setting it up, as I previously stated, and reading a lot of books and feeling really, really inspired to create now that things are finally getting settled. Really looking forward to seeing what the new year is going to bring. And yeah, like I'm just really excited, you guys. I'm excited that Art and Lore is finally happening after it's been in my head for so long. I hope it continues to improve with the video quality and the storytelling and just everything that goes along with it. I'm really excited that Raven Reads decided to collaborate with me on this. I don't think I've been excited about something like this in a really long time, which is really, really nice. And it's really fun. And that was my main thing, was to make this fun and entertaining and something that was different than what other art channels are doing on YouTube. So hopefully I can be that for you. Hopefully she can be that for you. And yeah, I'm really, really looking forward to this year. I feel like I've been babbling for so long. I'm so sorry, you guys. I don't know why, but like it feels like it got definitely, like we started like all hype and excited and then it got down to like a little melancholy or whatever. But like I do feel like I'm, you know, being as real and honest as I can as far as, you know, life and the channel and projects and, you know, things like that. Like I just, I like to be raw, but not share too much because I do like to have, you know, a piece of myself to myself. But, yeah, man, I'm just so excited. I'm so excited about this. And I hope you guys are too. I really would love, I can't honestly, my brain, it's not letting me form the sentences, but, yeah, I'm very excited. Right now I still have so much anxiety as I'm filming and recording this because I have no idea how it went. I have no idea how you guys reacted to it, if you reacted to it, if you even saw it for that matter. I have no idea what's happening right now. So I'm just at this point, fingers crossed. Hope you liked it. Hope you like the art commentary also because I don't know how I feel about this. I feel like it's important to kind of do like the artist commentary, but even though I didn't really talk much about the piece in this one because I feel like Art and Lore needed to be explained a little bit and, you know, plans needed to be executed and laid out for you guys so you understand what I'm trying to do, what we're trying to do with it, and hopefully it's received well, because it would probably suck if it didn't. It really would, because it sucks when you're really excited about something and it's not received well. But it is what it is. And as far as I know, we're going to continue on for now. So unless something changes, I feel like it's a gap that needs to be filled, though. I don't see this much on the internet. I know there's a lot of artists inspired by folklore and stories and mythology and things like that, but I don't think story and art has been officially combined the way that it's being combined, the way me and Raven are doing it. So hopefully it's received well. Hopefully you guys liked it. If you did, definitely let me know in the comments, and any future stories that you would like to see illustrated and narrated in this way, because I gotta tell you, we're pretty excited about it. I'm really hoping it goes well for, you know, the 800th time of me saying that. You know, and if you didn't like it, that sucks, and I guess you're not my people, which is totally fine. It's cool. Whether you liked it or didn't like it, let me know in the comments, because feedback is necessary to continue on and to improve the series, obviously. Okay, so let's start wrapping this up because there's only a few minutes left here of the painting process, which I hope you enjoyed watching, by the way. I definitely ran into a lot of problems on this piece, and it stayed in the ugly stage for such a long time because it didn't start coming together until the weeds in the front were put in, you know, to push everything back. So it looked really kind of like, not disfigured, but like out of proportion because the weeds weren't in the front at first. So like I had to work from back to front from with this one, and it was really hard to see the bigger picture in the end. But once them final details, it's always the final details that just make it so much better and finally pull everything together the way you anticipated. So it was nice to see that it did come out very similar to my thumbnail, which I was very, very happy with. Loved the color palette, loved it all. The one thing I do wish I would have changed about this was the dimension of the piece itself. Like, I feel like it would have looked better if it was more of a cinematic kind of rectangle with, like, you know, like how the movie has the two bars on the top when you go to the cinema. I feel like it would have looked better if it was longer or wider, whatever technical term you would like to use. I do feel like it would have looked better like that, but I'm very happy with how this turned out, and I'm happy that I pushed through to the end, because I tell you what, for a while there, I really wanted to rip this one up, and it was not a great feeling, but I was feeling very frustrated at the time, and still trying to set up the studio and trying to figure out how I wanted to work, and I was missing half of my supplies because I didn't have them in the right spots yet. So it was definitely a challenge, but I am, again, happy with the end result. So I would like to obviously say a huge thank you to Raven Reads for, again, collabing with me, narrating, and just being a part of this project, because I don't think I would have the ability to do it without her the way that I wanted it to be produced. And when you have somebody else relying on you, I feel like it's more likely to get done. So we both have agreed to give this a certain amount of time and do it properly. So fingers crossed you guys like it for the 100th time. If you have not signed up to my email list yet, if you would like early access to videos like this one, free phone wallpapers, and a coupon code for my store, you can go to kellypaints.com. I will have a link in the video description so you can sign up and get all the freebies and early access. And just be part of my email squad, because if I'm being honest, they get all the perks. They get early access to shop updates. I send out special coupon codes that only my email list has. And they obviously have now the secret page called The Seller, where I hide all of my fun stuff that I'm not quite ready to share with the world yet. I will also have the collaboration playlist for Art and Lore linked in the video description, along with on the end card here. So you guys can check out the whole entire Art and Lore playlist that we collaborated on. So she'll put a video in, and then I'll put a video in, and then we'll continue to do that until we decide Art and Lore isn't a thing anymore, which hopefully doesn't happen for a very long time. Also, I have links to Raven's channel if you love Reddit stories, cryptids, stories in the rain, horror stories, anything with narrative finesse in the horrorish genre. She's fantastic, and I highly recommend you go check her out. I definitely love listening to her channel while I'm working on my pieces. It definitely helps the process go a little bit better and faster and more enjoyable, if I'm being honest. So all of those links will definitely be in the video description. Be sure to check them out. Don't forget to leave your thoughts and comments in hopefully future story suggestions in the comments below. We would love to hear what you think. I hope you enjoyed the first episodes of the Art and Lore collaboration, along with the artist commentary of Art and Lore. Here are some close-ups. Thank you so much for watching. And until next time, don't stop believin'.